Yeah. All right. So my title is How Mother's Rare Cells Teach Us Both Tolerance and Immunity by Decorating Our Dendritic Cells with Her Exosomes. Or, simpler title, believe me, it'll be good for you if you ever get pregnant or get a transplant from someone like me, antigenically like me. So this is a story which is starting quite early in the history of transplantation with a guy named Ray Owen, who is from Wisconsin, from a dairy farm in Wisconsin, actually grew up there, and became perhaps the founder of the concept of transplantation tolerance as we know it. I'm going to talk about Ray. I want to talk about how I got interested in mother's rare cells in the context of transplantation research. And then I want to talk about immunity and tolerance. Okay, do we really need it in pregnancy? The answer is yes, both. We need both, actually. In transplantation, in transplant patients, yes, but we mostly need tolerance. So we want to kind of, you know, shift the balance over there. In cancer and infection, yes, but we want to shift mostly to immunity. So I'm then want to talk to you about multitasking at the single cell level. This is where it's going to get a little heavy. I'll try to keep it as visual as I can. And then our conclusions from that. Okay, so some of you may have seen this. This was an article that appeared in the New York Times 10 days ago. It was kind of, I'm told it had a lot of hits as far as a popular story by a guy named Carl Zimmer. And basically, I like the title, Pregnancy Souvenir, Cells That Are Not Your Own. So what Carl was talking about were new findings about what happens when a woman is pregnant as far as her own tissues becoming colonized with stem cells, okay? Fetal stem cell research is not a popular topic, but it's actually what's been going on for thousands of years. So for thousands of years, these stem cells have been populating mother in various different places. And I'll just give you one example. The heart up here that, do I get a pointer? I guess I do. Do I have a pointer? I do have a pointer. Let's see how this works. Oh, sorry. Oh, oh man, that was my talk right there. Whoa, go back, go back, go back. All right, you got my whole talk right there. We're done. So if you look at, for instance, in the heart, literally the fetal cells are beating, are part of the beating heart. Women during pregnancy undergo something called, they have a transient cardiomyopathy, and it's been now found that these fetal cells, these fetal stem cells, enter her body through the placental circulation and actually colonize the heart and create a bridge so that mother's actually, the heart is actually only transiently cardiomyopathic. So stem cell therapy, regenerative medicine has already been invented. We just have to kind of shape it. So this this idea of the souvenir cells that are not your own leads to the word chimera. And the this is a mythical beast that is part lion, part goat, and part serpent. It's actually originated in Tuscany. These are this was an Etruscan statue, but it's been taken over as a symbol of the transplant society because that's exactly what we want to do. We want to remove the dysfunctional organ and put in a new organ from that's not your own, basically. So I like the, I don't know if you guys are up for a bad joke early this morning, but I'll get to that just a moment. What do you call a cheese that's not yours? You know this one? Nacho cheese, right? I mean, that's what we're dealing with. Okay, so this is our team, an example of how we work in transplantation. There's the MD on the left, here, Dr. Dixon Kaufman, and there's me, and we're doing what we think we're trying to figure out what's in that tube, I guess. But the important person is in behind. So if you happen to do a rotation in the lab, you will be this person. Okay, we'll get the glory and the perks, and you'll be back there doing the work. And actually, that's William Bricamonte back there, who I'll talk more about. But he's really the person that discovered all of this business about mother's exosomes decorating our cells. Okay, so I put this slide in here for Cliff. I don't know if Cliff has arrived yet, but he will be here. But Cliff Cho is a big Yankees fan. And I also did it for another reason. Little League baseball is a very good thing because it keeps the parents off the streets. Actually, Dr. Kaufman and I did coach a Little League team. So we have other kinds of working together as a team, you know, besides in the academic world. Okay, and it did keep us off the streets, didn't it? Okay, so this is a guy that I want you to know about. And also, I should say, Dixon is the Ray D. Owen Professor of Surgery. And so this name, Ray D. Owen, actually is something you ought to know. He's on Wikipedia now. We've managed to do that. One thing, this is a great picture. I love this picture. It's a picture of his California look. He went from a Wisconsin birth here and did his major research here that he's given great credit for. Dr. Hans Salinger has given many good talks about this particular paper, which is called The Immunogenetic Consequences of Vascular Anastomoses Between Bovine Twins. Was published in 1945, and it really launched the field of modern immunogenetics. Without this discovery, we would never have known about things like mixed chimerism. So what was happening, in brief, was there was an anastomotic connection between two dizygotic twins in utero, and when the twins were born, even though they look quite different, their blood type, Ray found, was a mixture, 50-50 mixture of the two SIBs. And this was a tremendous, tremendous boon in retrospect to the later work by Peter Medawar and others, really Peter Medawar's group who got the Nobel Prize. But I want to talk about the lesser known of Ray's accomplishments. And the lesser-known accomplishment I actually learned about in 1996, we organized a symposium for Ray. He came here, and this is more his Wisconsin look, I guess. I like this picture. This is the one we have up on Wikipedia. He looks a lot like my favorite actor, Peter Sellers, doing Inspector Clouseau. And I really think, you know, he's kind of got that bemused look, you know. But Ray was always a very humble man. This paper he told me about at the meeting. He said, well, you know, you might want to go look at this paper. So this paper appeared in PNAS in the year 1954, about 9 years after his major, major discovery about the cattle twins. And this was not a paper about full tolerance, but about what he calls, it's a rather humble title, Evidence for Actively Acquired Tolerance to Rh Antigens. And what this is the following. So we were talking about souvenirs and pregnancy souvenirs that happen in both directions. All right, so women here, any of you women here have had a child, you're carrying souvenirs from that child, but all the children are also carrying souvenirs from you, right? So basically what Ray postulated, he said, well, let's look at grandmother. So this is grandmother, this is grandchild here. So grandmother, and we want to know if grandmother being Rh positive endows the baby girl here with a capacity that when she grows up and is also pregnant with now with an Rh positive baby, if that imparts any advantage to her as far as tolerating that pregnancy. Okay, this is in the days before Rogam And so these women were not being treated in any other way. The danger, of course, is that we would have the problem of erythrobastosis fetalis. And so he was looking at both the ability of the mother who had an Rh-positive mother, who herself was Rh-negative, the ability of her to make an antibody as well as causing the disease. So I'll just sort of summarize this. And the reason I put this whole thing up is because English language is really a precious and vanishing art. And Ray had a way of expressing what he found. So let me just show you this. So it says, I think you guys can read the data presented suggesting that the probability of developing Rh antibody in an early Rh positive pregnancy is related to the Rh type of the mother of the Rh negative woman involved. Rh negative daughters of Rh positive women appear to enjoy relative tolerance to the Rh antigen compared to Rh negative daughters of Rh negative women when antibody tests on their sera are used as a criteria of detection and classification of tolerance. Remember, this is in the days even before people knew about T cells. This was all we had was serology. This relationship of the maternal type, however, does not appear to hold when the appearance of erythrobastosis is used as a criterion for detection of intolerance. A possible explanation for this apparent inconsistency is suggested. Then he goes on to say presentation of this hypothesis on the basis of admittedly-limited data is justified by the hope that others in a position to test it will be encouraged to do so. I just thought, wow, that was inviting the scientific community to test this idea of a different kind of tolerance. So this is not a pure tolerance, right? It didn't actually prevent erythroblastosis fetalis. In fact, the women who had the Rh-positive mother, when they had erythroblastosis, seemed to have a more vigorous form of it. So, but the key observation, he said, was this: the fact that the woman who had an Rh-positive mother herself was very much, had a very much reduced risk of presenting with an Rh antibody. So how does this relate to transplant? Okay, so this is now, we're dialing ahead. This is 1998 here. This is a paper that I was privileged to be lead author on with a great group of colleagues around North America and Europe. And what this says, essentially, one has to look at this this diagram first on the right. And once you get the hang of this, I think the rest of my talk will be very clear. So here we're not looking at Rh. We're looking at a different antigen. This is the HLA locus, consisting of class 1 and class 2 HLA, and it's all on chromosome 6. So if you inherited the B and the D haplotype, those HLA antigens create a situation in which your mother, who is also A and B, those A alleles would be in your body because of the pregnancy souvenir principle, right? Okay? So you've got A in your body, okay? You do not have C in your body. So this potential end-stage renal patient who's going to get a transplant from one of her siblings doesn't have C but does have A. All right? So what's the consequence of this? So what you see on the left-hand side is, and we kind of put HLA identical siblings as the kind of the gold standard, right? Those get the best transplant survival in living donor kidney transplantation, in fact, in all transplantation. And then next to that, we put the survival of sibling donor transplants expressing the non-inherited maternal antigen, so the antigen A. So when you have that in your body, that souvenir of mother, you're going to do as well with that sibling that has that same set of antigens on chromosome 6. You're going to do the same as if you were HLA identical, if the donor was HLA identical to you. In contrast, the sibling donor is expressing the non-inherited paternal antigen, that is C, is clearly doing what we expect of a haplomismatched transplant. So just one other thing, though. Just like Ray found that there was a catch to this, okay? Ray found that, yes, mothers of RH babies, of RH positive babies, didn't make as much antibody, but they still had erythroblastosis. In our case, we had great long-term survival, but look at the early acute rejections, okay? The early acute rejection story is just is almost opposite. So the sibling donor expresses anemia, rejects much quicker and more thoroughly, 80% or more reject by the second week. So this is the cost. So there's a long-term benefit, a short-term cost of this kind of tolerance. So what we do is we just to get you up to speed with story. So the two major findings by Ray Owen regarding immune tolerance led to the concept of mixed chimerism. Mixed chimerism today is the gold standard for tolerance. It's complete tolerance. It's full. It's not split, okay? You will not, if you have mixed chimerism with your donor, somehow we have to kind of reduce you to the level of an infant to do this practically by immunosuppression. But if we can do this, you will have you will not be bothered with any immunosuppressive drug therapy for the rest of your life. This mixed chimerism is the full tolerance, but the kind of tolerance that mother leaves behind in our bodies is split tolerance. And so it's what Ray basically said to me, you know what, this is the most controversial paper ever published, and people attack the finding and found it wrong in various different ways. I only had 54 patients, but I invited them to test it, and so he never felt really good about it. He was 99 years old when he died last fall, just short of his 99th birthday, and about 6 months later, this paper came out by Sing Sing Wei in Cell in basically spring of this year, and it proved cross-generational fitness was transferred from the grandmother to the daughter through these souvenirs, through these pregnancy souvenirs that were in her body that were actually protective. And Sing Sing Wei did this in a very, very elegant mouse model, which I won't go into, but it's like, almost lived to be 100, but he wanted to, but his finding was confirmed. And so what I want to tell you about is why this type of tolerance is split, okay? And that why we see this high acute rejection in transplants from split tolerance anemia, as well as the long-term benefit. Okay, so the idea of mixed chimerism when you have 50-50 mixture of blood cells actually can occur in a human patient, and did around the same time as Ray's paper came out. There was a woman who was, her name was, I think, Ms. McKenzie. She came in, she donated blood, she was doing her civic duty in England after the war, and there was only one problem. When they analyzed the blood, it was a mixture of A and B, or B and O, or somebody. It was like 50-50 mixture, and it was just like Ray's cat. So what was determined about this was it was a vanishing twin that had, actually a vanishing twin brother that had donated blood to this person, and their stem cells were in her body. So that can happen. But in order to detect the pregnancy souvenirs, we need very, very much more sensitive techniques. And these techniques emerged in the early 90s. And the surgeon who took advantage of this was Dr. Tom Starsel. So Tom Starsel was the first to use quantitative polymerase chain reaction to amplify the rare cell DNA and to give a number to attach to the souvenir concept, okay? The number was very, very low. So it's, I say 1/10 to the 1/3. That's actually way higher than most of it. It's mostly in the range of 1 in 10,000, 1 in 100,000, or even 1 in 1,000,000. So this term then, microchimerism, is born, right? It's microchimerism because we can now see it. We can only see it by amplifying rare DNA, but it's there. So Tom, being a rather bold individual, proposed that microchimerism is the key to tolerance. And not only that, but that microchimerism and tolerance to transplants are intimately related. And in fairness, it should be said that split tolerance may be enough for a liver transplant, okay? Certain types of transplants are, what, take a licking and keep on ticking. The liver regenerates, so it may be that the split nature of tolerance is okay for certain transplants, but not for others like pancreas or kidney transplantation. So this proposal that Tom made in 1992 based on analysis of women who had received a liver transplant from a male donor, found all over their bodies, found evidence by microchimerism of very, very rare cells. This proposal, like Ray Owen's original split tolerance paper, was taken as a challenge by transplant immunologists, including yours truly. And so I said, okay, well, let's test this idea. So this is a patient. Actually, this will be on your test. I actually use this on your CME to illustrate something. So this was our first patient that we studied in great detail. In fact, my lab was accused of only studying one patient for about 6 years, which is almost true. So it's a 16-year-old patient, 16-year-old young man with Charcot-Marie-Tooth syndrome and end-stage renal disease with focal sclerosing or focal glomerular in the nephropathy. In 1987, he was on the tail end of something that we call donor-specific transfusions, which was, when I got hired, that was the thing that we were doing, was actually giving blood transfusions from the donor to the recipient at that time. And so he actually received 3 donor-specific transfusions along with azathioprine to keep down the possibility of him making an antibody, which we did not want. And he, of course, did not. And then he was able to receive a transplant from his mother. And, of course, this transplant contains all of the non-inherited maternal antigens that that he's already been exposed to previously. So he stopped his cyclosporin at 3 months, his prednisone and azathioprine at 23 months, and his biopsy came back negative for acute rejection. There were some changes, though. There were little intimal hyperplasia going around in the vessels. But what you can see down here on the right is his complete course, which we plotted out. This is creatinine level. And you see there's that, you know, after you ceased immunosuppression, he still maintained pretty good creatinine out to about 8 years, 9 years post-transplant, at which time he underwent a biopsy, and there was also chronic rejection going on at that time. So he was lucky. He got another kidney transplant from a zero HLA mismatch donor shipped in, and the surgeons here did that. But let me focus you on this point here. This is the point I really want to get at. So in his blood, during this period of time, when I say here, the T-cell cloning period, we were able to find, using this qPCR technique. In fact, we collaborated with Tom Starcel's molecular biologist Massimo Trucco to do this. We were able to find rare cells, about 1 in 10,000 cells of maternal origin, circulating in his peripheral blood. And we also found these cells in his skin, actually. So it was a lot like what Tom Starcel was saying was happening with our patients. Okay. Now, what we were able to show is that his CTL, his CD8 cytotoxic T lymphocytes, were inergic. That is to say, we would put them in culture. We do a culture to try to coax these cells to make a killing reaction against mother, and they would not do it, okay? However, if we added IL-2, which is the growth factor for T cells, we could reverse this energy and create a cell line, in fact, create T cell clones. So we knew he wasn't deleted. So those are two aspects of tolerance that I want you to remember, if you can, about this, is that there's the clonal deletion, which would say, okay, he's completely doesn't have any T cells against mother. That's not the case. He did have T cells against mother's antigens, but he was unable to proliferate them until we gave IL-2. Now, once we gave the IL-2, we had these cells now no longer allergic. We could take his peripheral blood, right? And the maternal, if we added back that peripheral blood of the patient into the culture, it inhibited strongly his CTL response. So something in that peripheral blood was causing this anergic state or this non-proliferative state. So we analyzed this with immunomagnetic beads, which had just come out around the time that we did this 20 years ago, and we showed that we could remove the principle of the inhibition with antibodies to mother's non-inherited maternal antigen. So we could we concluded, and based on the qPCR results, we concluded that he had cells in his peripheral blood that inhibited by 75% his response, and the number of cells were only 10 that completely inhibited response, which made no sense at all because we had 20,000 CTL and all we calculated was 10 maternal cells. So this is a numerology problem. It's a numbers problem to try to figure out how so few cells could have such a strong effect. So you can observe a lot just by watching. Has Cliff arrived yet? He said he was going to be a little late. I think it's really true. If you think about it, the best way to get at the problem, at this issue of split tolerance, is going to be by watching. And so that's what William has been doing. The principle or the real thing that we did not suspect at the time when we studied this patient was that not only was the antigen present on mother, that is the antigen that was on the cells that we could pull out and that were the 10 cells that of hers, but that a tremendously a potential of the rare cells in mother is to produce exosomes. Exosomes look like this on conventional microscopy. This is using a technique which I'll talk about, image stream. Flow cytometry or imaging flow cytometry, it looks kind of like Pluto from the distance, you know, and then the flyby you get up close and that's, you have to do this with EM, right? So they actually are sort of little vesicles, which you can see here, and they're made in a late endosome of the cell called the multivesicular body. And certain of the cells of mother would be have this capacity and would be able to not only produce these, but also to coat the patient. In the case of the kidney transplant from mother, coat his cells with these antigens. So let's see. Did I have okay? So so it, let's do the numbers again. Let's do the numbers game for a moment. Let's say the maternal cell is one cell in 20,000, right? So if exosomes are part of how mother works, then out of these, out of the interior of the cells, these little multivesicular bodies are generating exosomes. And here I've said that the HLA class 1 is going to be on the surface of the exosome, and inside the exosome is going to be microRNAs and other different types of nucleic acids. So Robert Leckler is pictured here as a eminent transplant immunologist, and he proposes back in 2004 that in fact exosomes are the way that this cell here that can recognize the direct, what we call directly recognize the donor, can also see it on the surface of the recipient, Cyprian's APCs. In addition, the cell that recognizes not the whole antigen, but pieces of the antigen, that is the peptides, which are processed inside the cell, can be presented on the surface of the same cell. So this is the point at which what we see is now there's something coming together. There's two parts of the immune system. One is recognizing directly recognizing the foreign antigen of mother, and the other is looking at a peptide derived from her. So this is very important because Leckler was trying to figure out how these cells could help one another. So the CD4 cell on the bottom looking at the peptide can now help that cytotoxic T cell complete the acute rejection response, for example. Without the help of that cell on the bottom, the top cell is unable to complete the acute rejection. Even though we may have started it, it's unable to carry it through. All right, so this is our mouse breeding model. We had to do these studies in a mouse, we were very fortunate that this system had already been described previously, but without the addition of a transplant. When we breed a mouse where the mother is has two haplotypes, she's heterozygous, B by D, with the father that's B by B, we get half the siblings are still B by D. They're not of interest to us, but this one is very interesting to us. This is the sibling that didn't inherit the D antigen, but was exposed to D antigen. And then on the other hand, if you reverse the breeding and have the mother as homozygous and the paternal as heterozygous, you still get the same distribution, but in this case, this one was not exposed during pregnancy to D. And when we do a heart transplant into these mice, in fact, what we find is that 47% of the mice who have been exposed to D accept the heart transplant that expresses that antigen, okay? Whereas none of the mice that were in the control group did so. Okay, so the question now is, what about these mice and what makes this 47% different from the rest? So I'm saying it's a question of looking at the problem, and I don't want to show you a lot of flow cytometry data because it's probably going to carry too late, but I want to show you this because this is a way that you can look at rare cells and actually see them under a microscope. So normally what a flow cytometer does is it passes cells through a laser field and then just tells you, okay, how much green fluorescence, how much red fluorescence is on that cell? It gives you a number. So we're familiar with this in transplantation, we call MFI, right? The MFI of the patient, of their antibody response, for instance, you can measure this way. But if you want to know what the cell actually looks like that's passing through there, you have to have a camera. And so what this company did that made this machine was they put, instead of a photomultiplier tube, they put a camera so that 12 different images are made of the cell as they pass through in this rapid fire fashion. And all of this data is then analyzed in the different colors. And so one can get an actual look at the cell. So let me just show you what this looks like. So this is what happens after we do one of these analyses on our mice. So in the case of the very top two panels, This is a mouse that is part of this group. 45% of the mice that have 31 out of 68. And oh, by the way, there's William, who did all this work, who demonstrates, and I think this technique really elegantly demonstrates the difference. This is mother's cell. This is what her cell looks like with an antibody to a class 1 antigen. But the cells of her offspring don't look that way. When they have acquired antigen, this is, by the way, the technical term for this, and I hesitate to say this because I was told it wasn't appropriate for my talk, is cross-dressing. Okay, so just so you know, if you put that cross-dressing in, you'll find a lot of information about exosomes, and I call it decorating because that's the more politically acceptable term for my talk. But if you look down here, then there are, so these mice are, actually half of them don't have this phenomenon at all, okay? They're just like the control B6. So what about them? Are those are these mice the ones that didn't acquire, the ones that did acquire, how are they different? Are they different in terms of they're clearly different in terms of the intact intact class 1 and class 2, which is going to be seen by this antibody to KFD. But how about their exposure to the peptide? So this is the other pathway that I talked about, this internal pathway. In those mice that don't acquire the surface antigen, do they still have evidence of exposure? So in fact, they do. In fact, the mice that don't acquire the antigen actually have more of this peptide antigen. So they are processing and presenting on the internal just fine, okay? And in fact, it's up to 10% on average of the cells that have this this peptide from mother. So it's not that they haven't seen mother. It's not that they're not aware of mother. It's that they haven't acquired her exosomes on the surface, all right? So so this is now the other thing that you can do with the image stream is you can look for colocalization. I'm going to have to wind up pretty quick. So colocalization of two signals on the cell is impossible to determine by regular flow cytometry. But imaging flow cytometry, because you're looking actually at the cell, you can see if two signals, say for one molecule and another molecule, are close together or very far apart, okay, on the surface of the cell. So this is done by a computer program called, which comes with a thing called bright field similarity. So for instance, the class 2 antigen, which in the mouse is called IAFD, is co-localized with the class 1. You can see the dots in the same place. And we would look at that and say, okay, well, they're overlapping. Well, this gives you a number, and it gives you a number based on all the events in the field, right, of co-localization. So this number of 3 is a very high number. Anything over 1 is considered they're co-localized. Okay, as a aside, we can generate this phenomenon of co-localized expression of IA and the KFD with exosomes that are purified from the mouse serum. And we've also done this with patient serum. You can purify from patient serum exosomes, and there's kits to do this. And you'll notice that only the mice that have the membrane acquisition phenotype are able to recreate this phenomenon in vitro. This is all done in vitro with the parental cells. So you can see that they're able to express the class 2 and the class 1 on the dendritic cells, but the MAQ negative ones are not. Okay, so what happens when you do this? You take these exosomes that you purify, you throw them onto cells, and at 24 hours, you look at the cells, and what you see are these little exosomes. Really, this is a view of the exosomes here by themselves. This is with the expression of CD9. which is one of the things that the exosome has on the surface. And you can also see that the KFD, the class 1, and the class 2 are highly, highly co-localized in these exosomes. So they're sitting right attached to the surface of the cell. Okay, all right, so this is to let me know that we're really getting done here. The future ain't what it used to be. And what we really have now to consider is, what about the other molecules? Okay, we know that class 1 and class 2 are both on the exosome, and they're both together. Well, it turns out that there are two very important molecules that we have to consider. One of them is PD-L1, and the other is CD86. And I put as a control the YAE, the allopeptide. So the PD-L1, this is my only flow dating. You see, the kind of information you get from flow is different. You just get a dot. You don't get the picture. But I'm going to show you the picture after I show you the dots. So basically, all of the cells that are HDKFD dim that have acquired are now also PD-L1 positive. But there are considerable numbers of PD-L1 positive cells to begin with. So it's not like they're the only cells. But that's not the case in the case of CD86, which is a go signal. So this is a stop signal. The ligand on the T cell would be PD-1. And it's a rather famous stop signal now because we're using it to cure cancer, but immunotherapy, curing lung cancer by abolishing the stop signal. So the go ligand is on the cell, and the stop ligand is also on the cell. So what's going on? How can you have a go and a stop, and how can this work? Okay? The ligands for these two things are the T-cell that recognizes this peptide and the T-cell that recognizes actually IAFD, which is co-localized. Okay, so looking at the stop signal we find is excluded from the patches. All right, so now we're down at the cellular level and we're saying, oh, okay, both of these things are up, but the PD-L1 is not present in the patch. So you actually appreciate that here with the IA and the PD-L1 co-localization. You see the signal is still green and the signal here is still red. There's no yellow. The same thing happening here with the KFD. That little patch there is there's almost like a gap in the PD-L1 expression. So this thing is totally at the opposite end of the bright field similarity spectrum. In contrast, the YAE epitope, the peptide epitope, is colocalized. And if you look carefully, you see, okay, here's the YAE, the PD-L1. You're actually seeing a little bit of yellow happening here. Okay, so that's your eyeball. But what this is telling you is that if you look at a number of cells in the field, there are areas that PD-L1 is excluded, but you see these very bright events that indicate that some of the PD-L1 is indeed co-localized with the YAE. What about the CD86? CD86 is co-localized with the patches. So what you have is you have a situation where two different things are happening on the same cell. Okay. You've got the exosomes coming from the tissue resident cell. We think it's a dendritic cell mother. We haven't proven this yet, but we feel that a cell that can produce lots and lots of exosomes, okay? These exosomes come and bind to the surface, and they stay in these patches with CD86. And this CD86, we think, comes along with the exosome and binds in a positive recognition fashion with CD28. So this is the go signal right here. So the go signal is on the patches. However, the stop signal is co-localizing with the process antigen. And the stop signal, we feel, does not come with the exosome, but is actually encoded by microRNAs in the exosome so that we get functional reprogramming, increase the level of PD-L1, everywhere but on the surface where the exosomes have landed. And this is just to show you that these pathways are functional. This is a T cell assay where if the cell proliferates, the dye actually gets less, and you can see that in the positive control at mother, they all get less. In the cells with the DIM positive, these four C cells, which are recognizing the IAFD, the intact molecule, also proliferate, but the cells that don't have the membrane exposition don't proliferate. In contrast to this, the cell that recognizes the peptide, that is the YAE, those cells are perfectly good at proliferating in the KFD negative situation, but in the KFD positive DIM situation, that is the antigen acquisition or cross-stress situation of the dendritic cells, they only proliferate once. This is the control here. They go through one cell division and then stop. So they are completely, completely anergic. And then, of course, the question comes, can we reverse tolerance? And this is some work that William was able to do. He purified two different types of dendritic cells from the mice, showing that, okay, in vitro again, the semi-direct or the proliferation of the four C cells was completely dependent on the membrane acquisition. The non-MEQ mice did not proliferate, but it was just the opposite for the peptide. These cells from the acquisition positive mice were anergic in vitro. So QED, he did PD-L1 blockade, which is the technique that we're using in cancer patients currently in trials here and elsewhere, blocking the checkpoint, blocking the stop signal. And when you block that stop signal in vitro now, you completely restore the proliferation of the cells in both types of dendritic cells. And whereas in the non MAQ mice, they already proliferate, so they're not affected. So in summary, then, the mixed chimerism remains the gold standard of transplantation tolerance, and we are currently, and I say we, Dixon has a grant to do this in monkeys using haplo mismatched sibling monkeys, and we're working on that, and that's the gold standard. That's what we want to do clinically, and we're hoping that that's going to be the next step clinically, is to get mixed chimerism to occur. But in the meantime, we're left with this thing, microchimerism, which is the norm in mammals, and we're left with split tolerance rather than full tolerance. And then the split tolerance is enforced by the ability of the rare cell to produce exosome, and we figure this is allowing at least a 100-fold amplification of the antigen signal. And the process of antigen acquisition using exosomes creates both stop and go microdomains on the same cell. So actually, we've now visualized split tolerance at the single cell level. I just put this in at the end. This is an example of a person who benefited from this split tolerance. These are 36 years apart. This was the second kidney transplant ever done in the state of Wisconsin. She stopped her meds at 5 years, and this is an HLA identical person. And so, even though they're clearly not non-identical twins, the kidney has lasted until this lady died in 2009. So 42 years, 37 of which without any immunosuppression. So again, for certain well-matched kidney grafts, split tolerance may be enough. And in fact, mixed chimerism does work in HLA identicals. And so finally, this is my lab. We run a humanized mouse core service for any of you who want to try your stem cells or regenerating tissue. in a human environment, that is a mouse that expresses that has human cells. Well, we've been obsessed with NEMA for quite a while. Now we do other things. This is our group. There was William who did all the work that I talk about, Jeremy Sullivan to my right, and then to my left, Matt Brown, who and Vershali Agache, my grad students, Lynn Haynes, who also is here. She looks just as good, actually. I look much worse to wear right here. And this is our microsurgeon, Ying Zhao. So thank you very much.